I'm so glad you could join me for church today. I don't know about you, but this has been another wild week. I don't know how many times I'm going to say that to you when we start a broadcast, but I got to tell you, this one probably takes the cake. I can tell it's been a rough week because I've got my chocolate with me. I wore my Mr. Rogers sweater to bring me comfort. I even had a good friend call me and she says, "Can you just pray with me? I need some Jesus." And I thought, you know what? I think we all need some Jesus today and every day. And so I just want to pray for you as we start. And if you have any prayer needs or anything we can pray for you particularly, I hope you reach out to us with the prayer link below. But right now, let's just start this by bringing some Jesus. And so, Lord Jesus, I ask that you would meet us in this place. There is uncertainty, there is unrest, and we are weary of it all. And yet, Lord, in the midst of that, you come to us, and you meet us, and you strengthen us, and you give us hope once again by showing us that you are in control of all things, and that you are worthy to be trusted. And so, Lord, we come to you and ask now that you would bathe us with your peace, bathe us with your presence, bathe us with your love in what these days seems like a very harsh and cruel world. So come, Lord Jesus, come. Amen. Now, before we begin worship, ironically, I've got this great announcement that really ties into the state of our world right now. We are having a mental health night. This couldn't have been better timing, I gotta tell you. Student Ministries, well done. Because on January 20th, students are invited to this mental health night, parents on the January 23rd, and it's just gonna be a QA with some top professionals and people who really understand what it means to have a balance in your life. Let's face it, social, mental, physical, spiritual all need to be in order. And right now, I'll tell you, our mental health is being seriously challenged. So I don't know about you, but this seems like a perfect time for this and a perfect time for you to join us for that wonderful opportunity. So I hope we see you there. Now I hope you enjoy worship.
Here I lay my burdens down, lose my worries in your love, casting every care on you, as I have carried them enough. When I receive it now, here in the presence of the Lord. Oh, mercy is falling, falling. Lift up your hands, receive it.
Thank you for your tithes, offerings, charitable donations. We couldn't do what we do without you. And it's a joy to be partnering together with you in sharing and declaring the joy, the love, the hope of Jesus to this world around us. And you know, I would like to take a moment to speak a blessing over you. Our words are very powerful, and when we consider what has transpired over this last week, we're very much aware of how powerful words are. Proverbs 18 tells us that life and death are in the power of the words that we speak. And if we choose to speak life, then we'll enjoy the fruit of that. If we choose to speak death and hatred, then we will experience the fruit of that. And God has said to us in 2 Corinthians chapter 9, it says this, "And God is able to make all grace abound to you, that always, in every situation, you would not only have all sufficiency for everything, but that you would also have an abundance for every good deed." So I declare over you, in the name of Jesus, who has already blessed you in the heavenly places with every spiritual blessing, I declare that His grace is flowing towards you right now, that the grace that you need financially, the grace that you need spiritually, the grace that you need physically, the grace that you need, whether it's mind, body, soul, or spirit, the shalom presence of God carries with it a grace that is not only sufficient for you, but it will cause to rise up within and through you and an abundance for every good deed. So may God bless you, and may you walk in the shalom, peace, and presence of God.
Thank you.
When I was a kid, my family loved to go to the beach. And I remember just spending so many great days out in the ocean with my little paddleboard and with my family and really enjoying those times. But I do remember one time I got caught in a riptide. And I remember I started to panic a little bit because I tried to come in and I kept getting pushed out. And a lifeguard came by, which can be also alarmed, and he said, "Don't go in, go sideways." And that caught my attention. And I did that. Instead of trying to fight it head on, I went sideways. And you know what? It got me out of the riptide and into a place of safety where I could come back inside. Well, I don't know about you, but I feel like we have been fighting the waves and they've been crashing on us again and again and again. And just when we get up for a breath of air, another wave rolls in and we're gasping and sputtering for air all over again. And see, here's the thing though, is that I believe that God wants us to find a new way, to go out of the momentum that's pushing against us and go with his flow so we can get to a safe place. And so as I've been praying for you this year, and for this year, the word that just keeps coming back to my mind and my heart again and again is the word resilient. Resilient faith, resilient people, resilient churches. And as I've been thinking about that, I thought, what's it going to take for us to come through this hard season? And it's been a hard season, let's face it, and a long season. How are we going to come through even stronger? And how are we going to find a new way to get past the troubled seas and get to a place where we're no longer being beaten down by the waves all the time? In fact, I looked up the definition of resilient and it said this, is to be resilient is to spring back. It's rebounding, returning to the original form or position after being bent, compressed, or stretched. Recovering readily from shock, illness, depression, adversity, or the like. Buoyant, irrepressible. I think God wants you and I to be resilient this year. And so as I've been looking through the Bible at people who model that, who exemplify resiliency, the one that came to my mind that I want to share with you today is David. You remember David, the shepherd boy who killed Goliath, who became the king of Israel, who went through all sorts of adversity and yet never gave up. In fact, when he finally died, it was said of him that he was truly a man after God's own heart. I want some of that, and I hope you do too. And I want to bring you to a point of David's life when things weren't looking so good. He was in his own time of crisis. And David had been told by Saul that he would be the next king, or told by Solomon. Let's try that again. David was told by Solomon that he would be the next king because the current king, Saul, had failed. He had disobeyed God. And so God started giving David great victories, and Samuel anointed him to be the next king. And as David was getting more and more victories and battles and in difficult circumstances, Saul became crazy jealous. And he decided that David was a threat to his kingdom and he was going to have him killed. And so Saul went hunting for David. And it's interesting that in the passage I want to read to you now is what we see is David not as king, but David on the run. David, who's having the waves come crashing down on him right and left. And so David runs. In fact, if you look in 1 Samuel chapter 23, you see that David goes from place to place to place. He's hiding out from Saul in the wilderness. It says he's going into the desert and into Keilah, and he kept moving from place to place. He stayed in the wilderness strongholds in the hills of the desert of Ziph. He was in Horish. He stayed in the desert of Maon. He lived in the strongholds of the En-Gedi. And when we start this passage, it says that after Saul returned from pursuing the Philistines, because Saul was hot on his tail, and then Saul had to take care of a little problem with the Philistines, but then he came back, and David was hiding, Saul was told, in the desert of En-Gedi. Now, here's where I want to start, because you see, for David, I don't know about you, but it doesn't sound much different than quarantine from COVID-19, to be honest. David was stuck. He was in hiding. He was isolated. He was alone. He had his bubble with him. In this case, it was about 600 armed men. But he was coming up against Saul, who had like 30,000 men and mighty warriors. So David was in a time of fear. But here's the thing that this passage starts off, and so many commentators have said, that because David had been in the wilderness for something, just a couple of years even, because he had been in the wilderness, that was where God spoke to him. That's where God strengthened him. It wasn't a waste of time. It was a time where David was made ready for any challenge that would come his way. David became resilient. And so as we look at this passage, I want to read to you a quote from a man named Eugene Peterson. He said this, "In the wilderness years, as David was dealing with God, a sense of the sacred developed in him. In the solitude and silence and emptiness of the wilderness, uncluttered and undistracted by what everyone else was saying and doing, David was able to see God's glory. The wilderness taught David to see beauty everywhere. Through wilderness testing, David learned to see God in places and things he would never have thought to look previously. The holiness of the wilderness had entered David's soul, and now he saw holiness everywhere, even in Saul. You see, the mundane became the sacred. The isolation became an opportunity to worship and experience God's beauty and glory. And I wonder for you and for me how we are experiencing this COVID season. Are we feeling isolated, cooped up, defeated, and disappointed and depressed? Or are we truly letting God speak to us so that we might see his beauty and his glory and the holiness of this wilderness time? So now here's where the story gets a little weird, but it's important for you to see the importance of it because it's very significant. So I'm really going to read to you about Saul's bathroom break, to be honest, and you'll see why this makes a difference and why that's so important. So here's the thing. David's on the run. And it says, Saul took 3,000 able young men from all Israel and set out to look for David and his men near the crags of the wild goats. In other words, in Gedi, there's a lot of caves. It was a wilderness area. It was a great place to hide if you're on the lam. And the men said this. And so here's the thing. Saul came to the sheep pens along the way, and a cave was there. And Saul went in to relieve himself. The Bible just says it as it is, right? And you probably would have normally passed over that until I brought it to your attention. You may not be that thrilled about it. But here's the thing. This is real. This is the Bible. And David and his men were far back in the cave. And now try not to picture this too much. But here's the thing. Saul goes into the cave to do his business, not knowing that David and his men are in the back of the cave. 600 men hiding out in this cave. And Saul comes in thinking he's all alone. Not one of your greater moments for a king. But here's the thing. So Saul's in the cave. He's facing outwards. We don't need to go into any more detail than that. And then this is what David's men start whispering to him. They said, "This is the day the Lord spoke of when he said to you, 'I will give your enemy into your hands for you to deal with as your wish, as you wish.'" And so then David, can you imagine this? David, don't imagine too much, but David crept up unnoticed and he cut off a corner of Saul's robe. Saul didn't even know it happened. And he left the cave. And here's the thing. Is David's men were shocked. "David, you had your chance. You could have killed him. He was totally unarmed. He was totally unprepared. Why didn't you take his life? This guy's been trying to kill you for so long. Why would you do that?" But then it reminds me of the words in Romans chapter 12. "Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everyone. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my dear friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, 'It is mine to avenge. I will repay,' says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good." You see, David realized that there were evil people in this world, people who were wishing to cause him harm, particularly Saul. But he said, "You know what? This is the Lord's job to deal with this. My job is to be honoring. My job is to overcome evil with good." Now think about this last week. Think about these protests. Think about the craziness of what we saw. And the transition of power, the presidency of the United States. Now, I am not here to make a political statement. Please know that. I know that there are people on both sides of this issue, and I am not here to draw a line in the sand. I am here to help you see beyond the line in the sand to see God in the midst of this hard time. Because we need to respond to the harshness and the cruelty that we see in this world whatever your determination of that, of what it is, God wants us to look at these situations with His eyes and to fix our eyes on Jesus, as Hebrews 12 tells us, the author and the perfecter of faith. And see, this is what Matthew says to us. It says, you've heard it was said, eye for eye, tooth for tooth, but I tell you, do not resist an evil person. You've heard it said, love your neighbor and hate your enemy, but I tell you, love your enemies and pray for those who persecute you. Now, I realize that this doesn't resolve every question you have for this last week's happenings, but the two words I want you to see here is that we are called to love and we are called to pray. And for everyone who is listening to my voice right now, please know that you can do all your complaining or whatever you do with whatever the situation turned out in a way that you didn't like, which is probably everybody, right? But here's the thing. I want to say to you this, is that before you complain, pray. 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 If you see injustice, pray that God would make it right. If you see unrest, pray that God would bring rest. Pray that God would bring peace. Pray that God would bring hope. Pray that God would take away our uncertainty and our fear. Pray that we would see now God do a mighty work in bringing peace to our country and to our hearts. See, David was in a situation, not the same as what we're experiencing, but David was in a situation where, man, he was just in a terrible place. His life was being threatened. His way of life was horrible. And yet, here's the thing. He chose to honor God and not take the easy way out, not just going out and killing. And see, here's the thing about it, is David, even when he cut off the side of Saul's coat, right? While Saul was going to the bathroom, right? Even though David did that, it says that after that happened, and after his men, you know, were all upset, and David, you know, told him to stop it, and all that things, it says after David was conscience stricken for having cut off a corner of Saul's robe. And he said to his men, the Lord forbid that I should do such a thing to my master, the Lord's anointed, or lay my hand on him. For he's the anointed of the Lord. And with these words, David sharply rebuked his men and did not allow them to attack Saul. And Saul left the cave and went his way. You see, what David is saying here is that he respected Saul's role, even though this was his adversary. And David wanted to make sure that in however way that he responded to the evil that was before him, he wanted his heart to be pure. He wanted to be squeaky clean. I think of David when he incurred some other sin in his life and he wrote Psalm 51. I hope you read it if you get a chance. He said, create in me a pure heart, O God, and renew a steadfast spirit within me. So do you see how David dealt with his adversaries? He took special care when dealing with his enemies. With Saul, he showed him honor. It says in verse 8 that David went out of the cave and called out to Saul, my Lord and King. Now, imagine what's going through Saul's mind right now. Where was David right now? Well, he kind of figured it out pretty quick. And when Saul looked behind him, David bowed down and prostrated himself with his face to the ground. You see, David honored Saul because he was king. But then here's the thing that David did next. He spoke the truth. He called out the wrong that had been done. He said to Saul, why do you listen when men say David has been on harming you? This day you have seen with your own eyes how the Lord delivered you into my hands in the cave. Some urged me to kill you, but I spared you. I said, I will not lay my hand on my Lord because he is the Lord's anointed. And he didn't take vengeance. He said, see, my father, look at this piece of your robe in my hand. I cut off the corner of your robe and did not kill you. Now Saul realizes with shock and dismay that David was that close and had the ability to take his life when he was in that cave. But he says, see, there is nothing in my hand to indicate that I am guilty of wrongdoing or rebellion. I have not wronged you, but you are hunting me down to take my life. May the Lord judge between you and me. May the Lord avenge the wrongs you have done to me. But my hand will not touch you. As the old saying goes, from evildoers come evil deeds. So my hand will not touch you. I think of the words of Micah 6:8. He's shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Now, I realize that David's situation might be a big stretch to what we've experienced this last week, but hear me out, okay? See, here's the thing, is that David was being attacked by his adversaries. David's life was in danger. And yet in the midst of that, David chose to honor the Lord his God. And he treated his adversary with honor. He spoke the truth. He sought justice. He made it clear that he had done nothing wrong and that Saul was in the wrong. But he also didn't act out with vengeance. He chose to trust the Lord to take care of it, because he knew that the Lord had a plan for his life. And he knew that God would deal with his adversaries at the right time. And so as I look at the rest of the story, I realize that what happens when we seek to please God with our adversaries? It's interesting, when David finished saying this to Saul, Saul asked, "Is this your voice, David, my son?" And he wept. He wept aloud. "You are more righteous than I," he said. "You have treated me well, but I have treated you badly. You have just now told me about the good you did to me. The Lord delivered me into your hands, but you didn't kill me. When a man finds his enemy, does he let him get away unharmed? May the Lord reward you well for the way you treated me today. I know that you will surely be king, and that the kingdom of Israel will be established in your hands." You see, Proverbs says it best, "When a man's ways please the Lord, he makes even his enemies to be at peace with him." Now here's the truth. I don't know that if we behave rightly, if everyone is going to just say, "Okay, I'm so sorry. I was so wrong. Hey, let's just be friends." I'm not sure if that's going to happen right now in this time in our world. But I do know this. We still do the right thing. I do know this. David still chose to honor God and not go the way of vengeance. And so when I look at this, I realize that in David's situation, all things were made right. David didn't have to force the issue. He didn't have to take unfair advantage. He didn't get ahead of God. He let God take the lead. And that made all the difference. You see, I believe that David was resilient because he kept a pure heart before God, that he followed God's lead, and that he trusted God to make all things right. How about you? Right now, I know there are a lot of people who are really angry and really frustrated, and no one knows quite who to believe these days, but here's the truth of the matter. When all is said and done, I believe with all my heart that God is in control of our world and our future. There are a lot of things I don't know about what's going to happen next in our nation, but I know that I'm going to keep trusting Jesus. And that's not putting a Pollyanna covering over everything. It's not trying to pretend there aren't problems. There are plenty of problems, and we need to be working towards goodness here, right? But at the same time, we can't leave God out of the picture. We can't stop praying. We can't stop looking to our Lord to give us wisdom on how to deal with the injustices we see, whichever side of this you're on today. I believe that God meets us in the depths. I think of Psalm 40. These words say so much to me. The psalmist says, "I waited patiently for the Lord. He turned to me and heard my cry. He lifted me out of the slimy pit, out of the mud and mire. He set my feet on a rock and gave me a firm place to stand. He put a new song in my mouth, a hymn of praise to our God. Many will see and fear the Lord and put their trust in him. Blessed is the one who trusts in the Lord, who does not look to the proud. To those who have turned aside to false gods, many, Lord, my God, are the wonders you have done, the things you planned for us. None can compare with you. Were I to speak and tell of your deeds, they would be too many to declare." Oh, my friends, I just want to tell you today that even though these weeks get crazier and crazier, politics is at an all-time unbelievable level. COVID-19 is at its worst. But here's the thing. This isn't the end of the story. God has a plan to see us through. And the question is, will you come through this time bitter or better? Will you be strong or will you be weakened? More importantly, will you be the resilient person that God created you to be? You see, David didn't just trust God when things were good. He trusted God even when he was fleeing for his life. And in the midst of his wilderness experience, God met him in a powerful way. And my prayer for you today is that God would meet you in the midst of this wilderness and set you on solid ground. So Lord, I just pray for every person who is listening here today, that today is a day that you would meet us in our own wilderness, and that we would choose to trust you to make things right, even when things seem so wrong, and that we would pray for our adversaries. We would pray for those who wish us harm. We would pray that you would make yourself known to them, and that you would bring goodness out of the hard that is before us this day. Lord, I pray that we would trust you. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, I searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. A man's empty praise, treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied, hearing your love. Oh, there's nothing better than you. Oh, there's nothing better than you, Lord. There's nothing, nothing is better than you. Oh, I'm not afraid to show you my weakness. Cause the God of the mountain is the God of the valley. There's not a place your mercy and grace won't find.